Thank you very much for the kind introduction and the opportunity to present the data today. It's my pleasure to give you an overview on our research focus in autoimmune type 1 diabetes. Why focusing on autoimmune type 1 diabetes? The incidence of childhood type 1 diabetes is rising dramatically, especially in young children. Nearly 90,000 children newly develop type 1 diabetes each year, and the number of children affected with type 1 diabetes is doubling every 12 years. So how can we halt this increasing incidence? We do know that the disease is characterized by an overshooting immune activation while immune tolerance is impaired. One critical goal is therefore to restore immune tolerance, and here FOXP3 positive regulatory T cells called Treg cells function as critical cellular mediators of immune tolerance and are therefore also referred to as the blue helmets or the peacekeeping troops of the immune system. How can we induce these regulatory T cells? We showed that this works best using naive T cells, stimulation with a strong agonist ligand provided under so-called sub-immunogenic conditions, which will then result in efficient Treg induction. Since insulin epitopes are the main target of the autoimmune attack in type 1 diabetes, we focused on insulin-specific Treg induction. It became, however, clear that those epitopes are not strong, but rather weak agonistic ligand, which then resulted in an impaired Treg induction. We then asked, how can we improve this insulin-specific Treg induction? And we therefore devised strong agonistic mimetopes, which then resulted in an efficient Treg induction. And we then asked, can these strong agonistic insulin mimetopes indeed impact type 1 diabetes by inducing immune tolerance? And we therefore performed immune fluorescent stainings of pancreatic sections in murine type 1 diabetes, as shown here for insulin in green, the blue fluorescent DARPI stain as a control, and we showed that FOXP3 positive Treg cells induced by these insulin mimetopes, as shown here in red, can indeed protect from the destruction of the insulin-producing beta cells in the pancreas and thereby prevent type 1 diabetes. However, our understanding of how to induce these human regulatory T cells is still in its infancy. The fact that in human type 1 diabetes, these critical insulin epitopes are likewise not strong but weak agonistic ligands, which resulted in an impaired Treg induction, supported our interest to study the translatability of these insulin mimetopes in human type 1 diabetes. And to give you an idea, this table shows the relevant part of peptide sequences of four insulin mimetopes and the insulin beta chain epitope as a weak agonistic ligand in red. The sequences are shown as one-letter amino acid codes, meaning each letter refers to one amino acid. The mutated amino acids are outlined in blue, and critical MHC class II anchor residues are marked as P1 and P9, and the T-cell receptor contact residue, TCR, is marked as P8. So building up on molecular work from John Kapler's group and based on structural insights of a human insulin peptide HLA-DQ8 complex, as shown here for the insulin peptide backbone in yellow, we devised two strong agonistic insulin mimetopes, which included the modification relevant for murine type 1 diabetes at P8 and P9, and one additional modification at position P1 in order to improve binding to human HLA-DQ8, thereby turning them into human strong agonistic ligands. We then asked, how can we induce these human Treg in vivo? And to this end, we reconstituted immune-deficient NSG mice with human hematopoietic stem cells, thereby permitting the development of humanized mice. And when we then looked 5 weeks later for reconstitution, we, as shown here for human CD45 on the x-axis versus murine CD45 on the y-axis, we observed a high engraftment efficacy with nearly 80% of the cells being human CD45-positive immune cells. And with this, within the human CD45-positive population, we also identify CD4-positive T cells. And when you focus here in the blue dots within the rectangle, we also identify insulin-specific T cells, indicating the successful development of human CD4-positive T cells, including insulin-specific T cells in these humanized mice. So how to induce these regulatory T cells in vivo? We therefore used these humanized mice, and for in vivo Treg induction, we applied these strong agonistic insulin mimetopes under sub-immunogenic condition using osmotic mini-pumps, and then looked at these regulatory T cells in mesenteric lymph nodes, blood, and spleen. And what we observed was that the application of these insulin mimetopes results in increased frequencies of human regulatory T cells, as shown here in the blue bar. And as again shown here in these blue bars, these Treg presented with increased abundance of critical signature genes such as FOXP3 or CTLA4 or IL-2 receptor alpha. And of course, if you think of a future vaccination, this Treg induction was not associated with the induction of any effector cell responses, such as again shown in the blue bars, IL-17 receptor alpha or IL-21, indicating that the application of these human insulin mimetopes results in increased Treg induction in these humanized mice. Of course, we asked the question, are these induced Tregs actually functional? And here, a critical feature of the functionality of these Tregs is their ability to suppress responder cell proliferation. And to this end, we co-cultured various ratios of these Tregs with responder cells. And as you see here, in an insulin-specific manner, those Tregs were able to suppress responder cell proliferation, indicating that these induced human Tregs are actually functional and suppressive. Of course, we then asked the question, what is the relevance for childhood type 1 diabetes? Or more specifically, is this actually the right thing to do? Meaning, is there evidence in children with ongoing islet autoimmunity that such insulin-specific Tregs can actually impact the progression to type 1 diabetes? And to this end, we analyzed insulin-specific Treg cells in peripheral blood of children with different durations of islet autoimmunity. Specifically, we focused on critical immune checkpoints, and here we have learned that once islet autoimmunity is established, as indicated here by the onset of islet autoimmunity and the arrow in red, the progression to clinical diabetes can be either fast or also very slow. And when we then look at these insulin-specific Treg cells, we observe a critical decline, especially during onset of islet autoimmunity. This is in contrast to children with a slow progression to clinical diabetes, which harbor distinctly increased frequencies of regulatory T cells. And this is again in strong contrast to children with a fast and fulminant progression to type 1 diabetes below the age of 5, therefore indicating that high frequencies of insulin-specific Tregs do associate with slow progression to type 1 diabetes. And these findings therefore directly support the rationale of inducing these insulin-specific Tregs for delaying or even preventing progression to type 1 diabetes. Critical next steps will now be to answer the question, how can we actually optimize Treg induction during ongoing islet autoimmunity, where it will be specifically critical to maintain these sub-immunogenic conditions? And I will give you two examples in a nutshell of how we are currently addressing this question. When we again looked at these T cells from children at different duration of islet autoimmunity, we observed a significant increase of microRNA 181A, especially during onset of islet autoimmunity. And we now show that this microRNA promotes immune activation and thereby links the transcription factor NFAT5 with an impairment in Treg induction. And when we then perform human Treg induction in the presence of a microRNA 181A and tagomere, we see that this can result in a significant improvement of Treg induction even during ongoing islet autoimmunity. Likewise, when we apply a pharmacological NFAT5 inhibitor to humanized mice, we observe that this results in significantly increased frequencies of human regulatory T cells, thereby indicating that the inhibition of this microRNA 181A NFAT5 signaling can improve Treg induction even during ongoing islet autoimmunity. As a second example, we focused on microRNA 92A, which we again found significantly enhanced during onset of islet autoimmunity. And when we then performed immune fluorescent staining of NOD mice, a model for murine type 1 diabetes with ongoing islet autoimmunity, as shown here for insulin in white, CD4 in green, and FOXP3 in red, We observed that the application of a microRNA 92A Antagomer results in a significant reduction of CD4-positive T-cell infiltration directly in the pancreas, while FOXP3-positive regulatory T-cells were increased, thereby supporting the notion that inhibition of microRNA 92A is actually able to reduce immune activation in the pancreas. So given the broad medical implications of immune tolerance besides pancreas, we've also focused on tissue-specific immune tolerance in diabetes and obesity. And here we first looked at brain-residing Treg cells, where recent evidence suggests that the exposure to high-fat, high-sugar diets promotes local inflammation. And here the hypothalamus is key in controlling metabolism, and what we observed is that upon exposure to these high-fat, high-sugar diets, we find a significant and progressive decline of these hypothalamic residing Treg cells. We then asked the question, are these Tregs actually relevant to interfere with local inflammation? And therefore, we performed gain-of-function experiments by local Treg transfers. And what we observed was that these Treg transfers permitted a significant decline of infiltrating macrophages directly in the hypothalamus, indicating that these local Tregs can contribute to a reduction of immune activation induced by high-caloric feeding. As a second example, we asked the question, how do environmental stimuli, such as cold, link T-cell tolerance with metabolic control in adipose tissue? And we therefore analyzed regulatory T-cells residing in various adipose tissue and performed cold exposure, which is critical also in the regulation of energy expenditure. And what we observe were, when we look at these Tregs in brown adipose tissue, subcutaneous white or visceral white, that the exposure to cold resulted in a significant enhancement of these locally residing Treg cells. Overall, supporting the notion that these tissue-specific Tregs are critical to control inflammation, but can also be involved to support local metabolic integrity. So this leads to my summary, what I've shown you, that we have identified human insulin mimetopes, which are relevant to induce human regulatory T cells in a setting of humanized mice. I show you that in children, high frequencies of insulin-specific Tregs do associate with slow progression to type 1 diabetes. And we show that when we inhibit the microRNA 181A and FAT5, or also the microRNA 92A signaling, that this can improve Treg induction during ongoing islet autoimmunity. So what are critical next steps for translation, what we like to do now, to model islet autoimmunity in humanized mice, to dissect these mechanisms in vivo? We are interested to study suitable delivery strategies for these insulin mimetopes. And of course, with respect to the window of application, we focus on combinatorial strategies to improve Treg induction during ongoing islet autoimmunity. And all in all, we hope that this brings us one step closer towards our vision of restoring immune tolerance in children at risk of type 1 diabetes. All in all, these studies integrate into our translational immunology approach to dissect mechanisms of immune tolerance in diabetes, with the overall vision to restore immune tolerance for prevention of diabetes. So this leads to my two most important slides. I would like to thank at the Helmholtz Center in Munich, Günter Wess, Annette Ziegler, Matthias Tschöpp, and also Martin Rabe de Angelis, of course, all the members of my group, collaboration partners, funding sources, and most importantly, I would like to thank all study participants, families, and especially their children, who with their invaluable blood donations made most of these research only possible. And with this, I'd like to thank you for your attention, and I'm happy to take any questions. Thank you very much.